Hello, everybody.
Hello.
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 We are gathered here together in the name of specialty of possibility coaching. We are calling you from Archie Maker Faire in Portugal. And all these guys are delivering emotional healing processes, and they are delivering possibility coaching. And so I thought, well, we're having a possibility coaching party, so let's all come together and share stuff. So we're going to share a little bit from the fair with you guys, just so you have a glimpse of the space over here. So anything about coaching, anything about processes, or anything from the fair so far?
Yes, there's a lot of creation popping up, and it's coming very naturally. And what I'm discovering is that to be in a space with a clear purpose of creating, sourcing, not just to consume, it brings me a lot of joy, and it's abundant. There's abundance. And one of the examples I have is that I was walking outside and I came into Jacqueline and we started saying, I want to create something about a website. And in less than 1 minute, we created a website series for 3 days. So this is how it's going in here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, your guys' turn over there. Could you turn the whole thing just a little further? Just one. That's good. We're waiting for you. Anybody from your over there on the computer?
There's Tristan also here, but we cannot see you, Tristan.
Sorry. Now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now. Hello, Tristan.
Hello, team.
This is
hello.
There's no dead time, so go ahead. We got six people over here. We have our attention on you. What do you have to share with us?
What's the question? I didn't get the question. Like, I didn't hear it well.
Hello.
Hello.
That's the question. Go.
I'm hearing you, and I hear also what Sonia brought about not consuming, and I'm in this process of how to offer in this archy way, because I'm not selling anything. I'm here to because I'm from archy right now. Now I declare that, I'm here to offer things coming from there. And I really saw when Sonia said that it's not about consuming. So I'm now on Saturday, I'm going to hold space for a rich club here. And I see that it's, I changed my speech, I changed my mind, I changed the roots many times, because it's really talking about the being. And it's also now talking about coaching here, because I'm also doing coaching here in Bologna, Italy, but not only. And I'm also like seeing myself in this way of how can I continue showing the value of this work. And there's a shift now, and I think that I'm there, but I'm here also to to be in a team with you, because coaching, like doing the individual sessions, make me feel like separate. So also the sensation here is to have a team to bring things that comes from my individual sessions, for example.
For me, from my viewpoint, the best way to announce the value of possibility coaching is to deliver possibility coaching. When your clients get a new possibility, instead of going into analysis, into their heads, into thinking, into trying to figure out the problem. See, possibility coaching is a kind of a different and new kind of coaching in the world. And perhaps you don't know this, but if you study coaching at all, I learned this mostly when they were making a movie called Coaching, a coaching movie called Leap. And we got all excited that they talked to us and said, we would like to include your kind of coaching in this film. And so they had 30 different kinds of different coaches, 30 different coaches in the film. And so I would go there. I was the main deliverer. I was delivering possibility coaching. They said, well, look, we don't know what possibility coaching is. We'll shoot a little side, do it with the camera lady. Do some possibility coaching with the camera lady. So she sits down across from me. I say, hello. I just look at her and I say, go ahead. And she just starts crying and starts telling me all this, because I'm holding this safe space. I mean, there's no pressure, I'm just listening. She goes for some minutes and then we make one little distinction and she's smiling again. And they go, wait a minute, what was that? Do it again. So we put another person in front of me and I said, what's your name? My name's here. Can I ask you a question? Now forget it, just go ahead. And second person started crying. And this rage came out. It was so big, this rage. So after the second one, the cameraman looks at me and says, do whatever you're doing. I don't know what you're doing, but don't do it to me. So, and that thing was this, it caused this shock in the coaching world, because I was the only person to speak with all four to do coaching with all four of the clients that they were filming. And they put almost no footage of my sessions with the clients in the movie, because it did not fit with any of the other kinds of coaching, because all of the other coaching was mental, it was intellectual, it was concept, it was theory. And so what you're delivering in the world is something that has not been delivered in the world. It's a new kind of coaching. It is contexted, not in analysis, not in understanding, not in thinking. It is contexted in clarity and possibility and love. So it's a completely different form of coaching. And because of that, it is highly effective for causing amazing changed results. And I think you all know that. You've had them personally yourself. You've seen it on your people over and over again. And so the way to make the value of possibility coaching known is do possibility coaching with people. We're starting our possibility coaching session and call it by that name. And then somebody will call you up and they'll say, could we do possibility coaching? You go, yes. It's like going to a steakhouse and going, can I have a steak? But,
you say the difference between emotional healing process. Why, like possibility coaching, it's more than emotional healing process.
Yes, emotional possibility coaching can include, well, it's not any different than emotional healing process. It is the same exact thing, because possibility coaching has this full domain where you might do, you work on a mind machine, you might work with removing an energetic block, you might have an old decision, you have a past life thing, you have childhood decisions. There's all these things that you're doing in possibility coaching that can happen in emotional healing process. So we're using the name emotional healing process as the domain in which people can practice until they realize they have skills in this domain. They're part of their non-material value is to deliver these processes for people. And it's a huge non-material value. And so that's when they can say, you know, gosh, maybe this is really what I'm here for. I'm going to do this for a while. And that's when you can start entering the possibility coaching specialty of possibilitator training and, you know, put the name on your business card, put it on your door, tell people on your website, you know, really what it is. Because you know, the whole thing is do 50, deliver 50 EHPs for free, then start delivering the next 50 EHPs for half price. By the time you have done 100 EHPs, you have 100 people out there who are enthusiastic about your work. You start calling yourself a possibility coach. Yes. So we're having a kind of a big circle here, six over there, and there's eight over here. And so it's not really a nice little cozy Zoom call. So I'm still asking you guys online, what did you come into this space with questions? Anybody have a question?
Yes, yeah. I have a question.
Go ahead, Katrin.
And it has more a logistical aspect. We have the commitment to record 10 coaching sessions in the mother tongue. And my question is, when Christine is not here anymore, can I send the recordings to you, Clinton, and you will put them online?
And Chloe just put up her hand. And so hold on a second. And Chloe, I don't know what the deal is, but any coaching we put online needs to be significant. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, unless you have a different website where you're putting up practice coaching sessions, what was the purpose, Katrin, what was the purpose of the videos? What's the purpose?
That is also, for me, it is the purpose, as I understood, is to have these coachings in the mother tongue and to have it also as a learning material. And for this, in my understanding, it requires also feedback. And I'm pretty new, or I just jumped over the border of having the first paid coaching session. So for me, it is also important to have this feedback.
Okay. So the page called Creating Possibility that has 100 already example coachings on it in English, that's full. That website's full. So if we're starting another website for possibility coaching in German, then we need demonstrations in German. That would be helpful. And so if that's the purpose, is to get coaching in German, then we talk to whoever's holding space for the German website for possibility coaching. That's not me. Is there some, so I don't know who else would do that. And so we don't need an answer right now, but that's what our situation is. I don't know which website, I don't know which website Christina Dershner was going to put those videos on. Do you know which one?
No.
I remember that the initial proposal, it was put in the main page, in the English page. But yeah.
Yeah, no, it's really hard to edit that page now. It's so full and slow, and it just is full. So we would start a new page, put it somewhere else, put it on the maybe possibility coaching in German. And we can put it on there. And Chloe, you were putting your hand up.
Yes, this means that, as you say, it needs to be quality. So send them if something can magic happen.
So what Chloe is saying is the ones to send to the website are the ones where really magic happens. you know, when there's a breakthrough, it's obvious,
yes.
You know, it's mind-blowing, like those are the ones to put on the website.
I'm happy to hear that. And then I would say it doesn't make sense to make it in Swiss German.
Well, there could be.
Why not?
No, why not?
Because not all German speaking people understand Swiss German, but Swiss Germans understand German.
Okay. Yes. So if you guys have miraculous, you know, coaching sessions, possibility coaching sessions in German, and then send them to Encloy and stick them on the possibilitycoaching.de. Okay?
Yes, I reach out to Encloy.
Tristan.
First make the coachings.
First make the coachings. Make coaching after coaching after coaching. Okay.
Yeah, I am
cold.
Curious about, yeah, I'm also cool, thank you. I'm curious about, so with the possibility coaching, there are also like, so my experience of coaching, the first part is to find like a contract. So I want to know, what is the person bringing and where do they want to go?
Wait.
And this is...
Wait a second.
Yes.
Okay. And it doesn't really have a lot to do with possibility coaching. That's
yeah.
More,
well, that's where my question is going.
Go ahead.
So what I'm hearing from you is the possibility coaching basically starts with what is coming in the space, and you just go there and it's this kind of one session, and a more are needed then more are needed.
Yes.
As opposed to finding the thing and then, okay, we're going to need four sessions for this.
Okay. That's therapy.
Da, 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 da.
That's a therapy model.
Mm.
I encourage you not to use a therapy model. No.
Can you say more about that, Clinton?
Yes. I only have a little bit of experience with therapy, but it has certain qualities. One of which is the therapist never actually wants you to heal, because then they lose a client. So they want you to come back for about 15 years, and then you can stop after 15 years. But that's the therapeutic model. Is actually you have some like Dear Mary or Mother Mary. It's like one of these, Dear Abby. It's like one of these, you have somebody to listen to you. So mm-hmm. Your therapist is there, they can come in and talk to your therapist, and it's kind of catharsis, a little bit of crying, a little bit of, but no clarity, no possibility, no new path, no transformation. You know, it's just like, so this is the therapeutic path. And part of that is, we'll make a plan for you. Do three sessions on this, and then we'll start working on your mother, and then your neighbors, and then school, and then we'll, by that, you know what I mean? And start really working it out over, and that's not how possibility coaching works. Possibility coaching is somebody comes in, they sit down and say, what can I do for you? And you do it. And then that's it. See, if you ever need to take a step again, give me a call. It's completely up to them. And does that make sense, Tristan, or what are you thinking?
Yeah. And if they have a topic, like say they are someone who has long-term anxiety.
Yeah.
Or
really short-term then.
Like say that again.
You're transformed into short-term anxiety in one session. Curious.
You never know when somebody will pass the eye of the needle.
Yeah, it's long-term anxiety. It's just a story. You know, they've had long-term anxiety because they've been going to medical doctors who give them pills to try to suppress the anxiety. Then they go to a therapist who wants to talk about it for a long time, and it doesn't do anything for your anxiety. You know, and so we know anxiety is fear, and it's an emotional fear, and then have the source. You can go to the source and complete it in one session. Then it's over. Then they have a new identity of a person who no longer has long-term anxiety. They have a new future. This is possibility coaching. And Chloe.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Possibility coaching is integrated with all the other dimensions of archaearchy and the path of evolution, which means rage club, which means fear club, which means expand the box, which means Roman transformation and adult ego state decontamination.
Read the books.
And the books, watch the movies, read the website. Otherwise, it's therapy. Because possibility coaching is very powerful for one particular issue. I mean, I know that it can be used for other things, but and possibility coaching, it really has this power for one past life, an old decision, a part of your being that was split off, an energetic block, a mimetic construct. And that can be handled in one session. However, it needs the matrix to hold it and to navigate it. And that's, I think possibility coaching is definitely not the best place to build matrix. It's not the place to build matrix.
I understand.
Okay.
Yeah, there's all these other ways to build matrix to hold the new future that they get in the possibility coaching session.
This was a misconfusion, a confusion that I did for myself then, because one of the ways that I'm using so far possibility coaching is to bridge people. So it's like, I don't know, arrive a person that never been in contact with conscious feeling, and then what can I do for you? And the person starts to bring the story, the problem, the emotion. And then somehow I have the intention to build, like bring some map or some distinctions and make experiments with the person. So I'm wondering, is it a different purpose or?
I mean, that's the stuff where they can get that in work talks, workshops. You know, they can get exactly that. And then you're delivering it to 20, 30, 40, 50 people at the same time, not one-on-one. Mm-hmm. So this is legend making. You know, you put people in a work talk, they do an exercise during the talk. They go home, they build matrix, they practice something, they come to the next work talk, and they come to the next workshop, then they come to the rage club, then they come to fear club. And it builds up the matrix in them. And like Anne Chloe said, when you build up the matrix, the process is like almost picking ripe fruit off of a tree. You come in, you pick the fruit, you hand it to them, and go, there you go, and you get paid for it. But if they didn't have the preparations to, and then you go to the fruit and it's not right. You start going, cut the tree down, you know, like get your bazooka out, try to take the fruit off, and it's not ready. And so it's really about building the matrix and Chloe.
One of the ways that I use it as bridge building, or like how you were saying it, Gabriela, is when people reach out to me and they have done nothing, they've only seen my website, for example. But they're interested in the work. And I would say, will you join a rage club? I encourage you to join a rage club. And I include often an email saying, and if joining a group is not what you need right now, or you would rather have a one-on-one session with me, I offer also possibility coaching. And I do one session, that people feel safer in a one-on-one than in a group. And what I do is basically learn how to feel mad, sad, glad, and scared. And we just do that. What do you feel right now? I feel angry. What do you feel right now? I feel sad. And so that they get a taste. But I said, look, if you really want to do this, do Rage Club next. And I usually don't do a second session with them, one session. Just has to create this as like a safer space.
Thank you. And just a curiosity, but if the person wants to keep going with you in the individual sessions, because there's a client that she said that she's not prepared, she has a baby to go to a rage club, she didn't want to go to my rich lab, but she said that she wants to continue in the individual sessions, for example.
Well, I'm gonna show up. I just needed a mini nap over there. What I would do, for example, with moms who have scheduling problem, I will say what I will offer to you is a rage club. And I do five sessions, and it's going to be five sessions of rage club.
One on one.
In terms of moms who have really difficulties with timing, because, for example, Nicole Hartley Bradford and Habet, they're trying to build this game wall of rage club for mothers, but this is just not there enough for me to be able to send single moms there. The game wall is not running yet so that the single moms can have this flexibility of getting rage club and with the kids and the things like that. So then it would be, you know, for me, it's like if a single mom said that, I said, I'm not the person for you to talk to. Because I don't do single mom thing. Or in different ways, but not in single coaching. So it would be a way that Marina, you're building a particular flavor, you know, a particular domain where you're willing, you know, you're, as you said, you know, you are in archaearchy, you're taking a stand for single moms with babies to be able to enter archaearchy. Like, I'm taking a stand for something else, but maybe that's the stand that you're taking. And therefore you will create forms of possibility coaching that might be also shorter in time. So that it can fit to those people that are coming to you.
And something that we're getting feedback about from moms is the using the Good Night Feelings book, who did not go through it. It's, we will have it in Portuguese and Spanish pretty soon, and it's in German and English already. And when that book enters a family as an evening ritual, their entire family context changes, it shifts. And so that's also really supportive of the mom being able to complete the day with the kid. The mom's complete, the kids are complete, and go to sleep. Get good night's sleep. You know, if you don't do that, these emotions are just churning around all night long and you're incomplete and it's just a mess. And it doesn't take long to be really crazy. So the Good Night Feelings book is a very powerful tool for families. And partners and grandmothers.
If you translate it in Italian, Marina, if you translate,
yeah, I...
which wouldn't take much. There's almost no, you know, the text is very short.
I have two books here in my house.
Okay, but they're in English.
They're in English, and this is one of the things that I was imagining to translate into Italian.
Okay, it really is not a big piece of work. You know, it would take a couple of weeks or something, and somebody who helps you with some words. I will, in a few months when I'm in Bali, I will do what the one in Portuguese and the one in Spanish. And if I have the one in Italian, I just do all of them at once, and that will save me time. So you get a month. Okay. Get 1 month to deliver me the
present. Okay.
Will you do
it? I will. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Cool. So I have a question. I was in a coaching session, and we came to a point, and the client got in contact with a huge fear, and I had the sense that. So it was an online session, and I had the sense that that would be too much or too intense, and I cannot hold a safe space for her in this online context. So I decided not to go there. And my question is, do you have some ideas or impulses to handle this or to do something else.
Marcus and I do. Go ahead, Marcus.
So what I'm recently discovering is that holding space for people who are feeling fear, the importance of my anger when I hold space for that person is immense. And the like, if I use my anger and if I speak clearly to them and I give clear instructions what to do, it really creates this safe container for the person to go crazy in their fear. And the moment that I when I faint out of that anger, the space becomes wobbly. So my proposal is to experiment with holding space from your anger very clear and raise it up to 80% even. You don't have to yell it like full loudness as in 333, but be very close to the participant. Don't let gaps happen, but yeah, stay close and also in your yes, just in your yes of encouraging them to even go more, like to do the next layer. You keep saying yeses, yes, yes, go, keep going. And so that creates the safe container.
What also creates a safe container is for you to go stellate your fear again. You know, do however somebody holds space, either online or offline, but to go, you stellate. When was the last time you stellated your fear?
Yeah, it's a few months ago.
Yeah. And so you build Matrix now, you build, you're a different person now. And so if you just go stellate, it doesn't take 10 or 15 minutes, that, you know, it doesn't take so long, and have somebody hold space for you and just go for it. And then you'll feel, okay, well, that's as big as it gets. I mean, I've done processes with people online where they hit stuff and they are laying on their bed and they just roll off the bed. I don't even see them. The camera's kind of shaking around, you know, and I can hear things. And they're just, you know, and they just got, I just keep doing what Marcus said, go, yes, go. And they can feel the space holding. And then they get to where they need to go. And they crawl back up on the bed and they go, that was amazing.
Yes.
I don't even see it. You know, I don't even know what they're doing down there. But for them, you're the space holder and the space holding works. And then when you can ask them, what percentage big do you think that was? You know, it goes something like, oh, 75. You say it can be 25% bigger than that. You go, what? Yeah. And say, okay, prove it. And you can throw them back into it. The thing is, when they go back into the fear the second time, and see where they were the first time. You don't just do it one time, do it again. And they go up and, you know, say, how, and to me, you know, they were already at 95, and now they did 97%. And I go, how, what percentage big was that? And they go, well, maybe it was 88%. No, that was 90%. So they have to set their feelings calibrator. So you can adjust the feelings calibrator right over the internet, right in the Zoom call, they adjust it. Okay, you say this can be 7% bigger than that. Well, yeah, okay, prove it, let's go. And so you're really making it safe with your space holding, with your rage, like Marcus said, this clarity and your commitment and your enthusiasm and your force, and that space holding for them makes it safe. There's no place else in the world they're gonna get that clarity and safety that you're okay with them completely freaking out. It's really, really valuable. Including—
Yes.
In addition, for me, it's also really every space, but especially spaces where people are considered new, especially to the intensity of feelings, I'm holding a space of, this is normal.
Mm-hmm.
Feeling 100% intensity feeling is ordinary. This is what humans do.
Mm-hmm.
There is no problem. There is no too much. It is just, you're designed for this. And that's from the beginning of any spaces that I hold.
Yeah.
However, I have experienced people who are victim, you know, they cannot get out of being victims of their feelings. They cannot, you know, and it's an addiction. It's an addiction to low drama. So now that we have words for it, it is useful to say it, because, you know, even if they come to you for one session or two sessions, don't hesitate to really give them their X on the map, because you don't know you know, it couldn't be like 5 years later, they say, you know, you said that thing and I didn't want to believe you. But then I started noticing that I was just a victim and a victim and a victim. And I hated you for 5 years, but now I'm ready. And now I'm tired of it. And so do not worry if people, you know, go away and need to, you know, process it or get in your face it. It, because there's really almost nowhere else that they can get this clarity that they have an addiction to be a victim. Everybody believes them or goes away because it's just so annoying to be around somebody who's just addicted to being a victim. So their life is shit because nobody ever told them. So it's really our job as possibility coach. This is your ex on the map. And, you know, maybe not in a first single coaching, but if it's somebody that, you know, comes to your possibility team, somebody who has come to your rage club, and this victimhood does not stop after one rage club. No, really, rage club can stop victimhood.
Yeah.
One rage club can stop victimhood. It's not like 15 years of therapy. So if after one rage club, they're not getting out of their victimhood, you can say things like, it seems like you love this.
Mm-hmm.
You love this. Like being sad about being angry or being sad about being scared or being scared about being scared. It's like, it seems like you love this.
Being angry about being angry. And so, can I say something?
Yes.
And I saw you were going to say something. You want to go first?
Yeah, because it's short. Also, I discovered in the holding space for fear is that it helped if I'm a bit faster than the box of the client and also my own box. Because when I let too much time, then there's this space for the person's box to create a worry out of the fear.
Mm-hmm.
The person is starting to become worried about their fear and basically going in loops in that.
Mm-hmm.
But when I hold space a little bit faster, then there's no space for the stories to go in. And then they actually get the chance to surf the wave of the feeling.
What I would like to say is do not hesitate when you find a person who's addicted to the low drama to actually send them directly into Violence Anonymous, VA, violenceanonymous.org, basically. Because they use a 12-step program there that is the thing that works with addiction. And we have a bunch of possibilitators in there right now.
And is an addiction to low drama. That's really what.
Yeah.
What,
and they are their central map in Violence Anonymous is the map of low drama from Stephen Cartman. And so they go through all 12 steps in each of the three positions. And there's this committed, the originator of Violence Anonymous is this main space holder for this meeting. He's such a great guy, and the team is such a great team, and people are reporting huge amounts of clarity and possibility coming out of that 12-step work. And then they can come back to possibility management and grow up. They cannot grow up if they're addicted.
What is amazing, I heard from Violence Anonymous, is to go to the meeting, because in the meeting, what you get to do is admit. You admit, I was in low drama, and this is how I created it, and I was in low drama, and this is how, and I was a victim, and I was a rescuer. And the fact to just say it over and over and over again in a space, there's no judgment, but also total clarity, that is the way, one of the ways to get out of addiction, to just admit it. Addiction is really kept, keeps going with secrecy.
Another thing about the fear is to coach people when they dissociate, because for some people, when it's a higher intensity fear and it's new for them, they can leave the body. And then it doesn't work to keep saying go, 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 because they're leaving their body. So then I think it's very important to notice this and to give this So then it's about the anger again. So yes, keep making the sounds and use this to come into your body, not leaving mm-hmm. your body. So it's like a shift of orientation.
Thank you.
Otherwise, they might feel all this fear, but it's not really, they're using it to go out of their body.
Yeah, yeah, that's important. Yeah.
And then every time they want to leave their body again, say it. Now you're leaving your body again, stay in.
Mm-hmm.
And also again, say it with anger. It needs this repetition of clarity also for the person to notice that they're leaving their body if they don't notice by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for the question. Anything else about that?
Yeah, I have something. It's related to the addiction to low drama. I noticed that most people have two favorite feelings. So they prefer to be angry or to go into the sadness. And it's also helpful for them to see, okay, I do it again. I choose the anger, not fear the fear or something like that. So it's also, yeah, helpful to say you do it again. And this is a kind of pattern.
I have a proposal about that. Because yes, it's useful for them to see, oh yes, I'm doing it again. But even more useful is to learn how they do it. How are they doing it? And the way they do it is with a story. And they have a story about themselves, a story about other people, and a story about the world. Like, how do I live in a world like this with people like them? You have stories, those three kinds of stories. Story about myself, story about other people, story about how I live in a world with people like them. A world like this with people like them. These are stories. And those stories will bring up those feelings. And so it isn't enough to say, oh, you're doing the anger and the sadness thing again. What's really valuable is going, looks like you're feeling something. How did you cause that to happen for yourself? What story did you use? And then to notice when they're about to bring the story into their mind, into their heart, you start to bring this story into their heart. And they go, hey, you know, I'm doing it again. And when they know the story, before they tell the story to themselves, they can go somewhere else. They don't have to keep going to the same dungeon, same dark place. They don't have to keep going there. But if they don't know how they caused it for themselves, then they'll think it's real. They'll think it's true. And they'll think, you know, that's what life is about.
I have something about that, and just, yes, thank you. In a slightly different way, a client will have a story in order to numb herself. She's not allowing, and then what I've noticed is how she swallows her feelings. She's swallowing her feelings or has different jittery ways in her body to numb in the moment.
So your feeling is numb.
Right.
Usually not.
Or fear.
Fear.
Usually fear. So the numbness is the fear. When she says she's feeling numb, what she's feeling is a high level of fear. And then you can relanguage it. You can say, please, instead of saying you're numb, say, I feel afraid. And she goes, I feel afraid. You say, why? Because she can tell you. Okay, so you get this shift?
Yes.
Yeah, the numbness is really, it's fear.
And confusion is also fear, right?
More anger. Confusion is anger.
Okay.
Something I discovered recently is that some clients have these really glued with the ego states. It's really like their point and anchor in the other ego state to notice, to see what are the stories, what is the feeling, what is the emotion. And a process that I did twice that worked quite well was with chairs. So I put four chairs and I asked the person to write the ego state. So she wrote, okay, here is my child ego state, here's my parent ego state, here's my gremlin ego state, and here's my adult. And it was quite interesting because one of these people, she put the adult like really in the corner, like really in the corner, and the child in the center. And the process was quite about that. The child was in the center of her life, the child ego state. And then the process was really like she started in the adult because she said that she was in the adult. And then each time she went to the emotion or trying to do the emotion in the process or the problem she was bringing, I was asking, what is this state? And she said, it's my adult. But she was saying like, I should do that. And then I said, no, this is not adult. Which state it is? And then she discovers, oh, actually it's parent. And then she stand up, moved to the parent ego state. And I encourage her to really go to the emotions of this state. So to really to the air, so when she accessed a lot of anger. So it was like this rage against herself, a lot of inner violence. And it was like that for 1 hour and 20 minutes, jumping from one chair to another. Until there was a moment that she created a gap between the states and the adult. And then she could access a feeling for the first time. And then she was like mind blowing. She was like, is it that be present? Touched so much my heart because it's like, wow. It was the first time she was feeling present in her body, in her physical body. So I share that as a possibility when you experiment, when you are with a client that is really in this victimhood jumping states and not moving anywhere. I call it ungluing, I think it was Jesse that gave that name, and I should have used ungluing ego states.
Ungluing ego states.
Yeah.
With a gap.
Thank you.
The last part.
Thank you, Gabriel.
That if you can see, it's not you. If you can see that it is, so it's not you, so you can do something about it. So you can feel, so you can see, so you can distinguish from you. You're not identified.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
I want to say something about the documentary because I tried to buy it through Amazon, but it's only in US. Do you have any possibility to reach this film, this movie?
Which movie?
The Leap.
I watched it on YouTube, I think.
YouTube.
Yes.
Can you send her the link?
Yes, I'll check it out and I'll send it to you.
Well, just send it to the group, okay? The Possibility Coaching group. Or send it to me and I'll put it.
Okay.
There's a possibility that I have the video, actually. So if the link doesn't work, I'll check my computer and I have it, and I can just put it somewhere. It's like how not to do coaching, basically. I mean, there's all kinds of stories behind the film. One story is that the original director of the film is Betsy Chassie. She's the lady who did the film, What the Bleep Do We Know? Anybody ever see the What the Bleep Do We Know film?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so she was the original director, but the producer, who's the money guy, was hooked by her. So they got into this battle. Anyway, while we were filming in Los Angeles, Betsy comes up to me and says, all these people are stuck in their heads. What are we going to do about it? And I said, well, my brother lives in the Southern California desert where the Joshua trees are, out in the sand and the coyotes and the rocks. And we can kidnap all four of the clients without telling them, drive them out into the desert, and then have them sleep overnight outside in no hotel, no room, in the sand, you know, and then with no toilet, no running water, no restaurant, and this will do something to get them out of their head. She goes, this is fantastic.
Yeah.
And so she rented a caravan, a trailer, and puts everybody in the trailer, and I got all this little tools. And so they step out of the camper van, and they're walking, and they have no idea where they are. I say, follow me. Here's your knife. I give each one a knife. And we walk out, and I say, you see these three Joshua trees? And then I don't know if you know what a Joshua tree is. It looks like it's a prehistoric, giant, multiple-branched yucca tree. They used to be eaten by the woolly mammoths. And like the large woolly elephants used to eat them. And so, and I said, in this triangle of Joshua trees is a safety zone. I want you to go out there and find a rock, three rocks, and put them in exactly the same shape. And that will be safe for you tonight from tarantulas, rattlesnakes, coyotes, and spider, well, anything else. So they all did this anyway. So this is the kind of coaching, the possibility coaching is it brings people closer to reality. We had this great talk, was holding the space. There was, no.
Yeah,
Gabrielle, what?
Radical freedom.
Yeah.
Which is basically
radical freedom space. We just did a radical freedom space today. Gabriella was a space holder. It was a fantastic research space. It was about getting into closer to reality. So this is what possibility coaching is about, is bringing people closer to reality. I mean, we're out there in the desert, and I say, and people are getting hungry. I say, well, we need to make a fire. And so, here's some sticks, and here's a rope, and here's how you pull it back and forth to heat up and the two sticks so it's hot enough to make a spark so we can start a fire without matches. And it took us about 45 minutes to get the fire started. But afterwards, they're standing out there in the desert, and they're just with their mouths open, they're looking up at the sky and going, I lived in a city my whole life. I have never seen stars before. I've never seen stars before. I never slept outside before. I never slept on the ground before. It was like such a real, so this is possibility coaching also. That kind of thing is possibility coaching. So don't hesitate to follow those impulses with people. We give them challenges, give them invitations to new dimensions or new domains, because this is part of possibility coaching.
This sounds much more fun.
Yeah.
Thank you for the distinction with closer to reality. I paused with the coaching because I has been ill a long time, and I thought I had the thought that I don't have enough power to do the things. And if I restart with not a lot of power, I realized that a few coachings really run the way, that the people stand on the edge, but they couldn't pass the edge as I felt it. And it was four times that afterwards the person, we ended the coaching, and then something happens that the people get an X on a map that their reality is totally different as they thought before. And thank you for that.
What were you going to say?
Something different. If you have to say something to that, it will be good if you say it.
No, I mean, people's lives change when you go, this is a feeling, and that's an emotion. And they can go, they can feel the difference. Their whole lives change. And it's these distinctions of getting over reality. There's such a powerful connection to reality. What else were you going to say, Martin?
I want to share a story about if you told about the exercise that's in the desert, I want to share a story about from the school of my son, because they make some kind of initiation there, that they send the children 1 week through the world. They have to make their own trip, and they don't have to use something electronics, or they don't have, they really have to go 5 days somewhere and to find their way, and really to make, I don't know the English word for that. To make their fire for their own, to make a tent for their own, that they have really to make a plan for all these things, really to come to reality on that space. And that's part of the children as they are 14 or 15 years old. And they make it in school, and I'm so happy about that. I want to share that.
Sounds like a pretty special school then. Does not sound
yes.
like a normal
it
school.
Is.
Yeah, great. Yeah. I've been actually having quite a bit of discussion here about what are the appropriate initiations for boys and for girls at the different ages. So if you have some ideas about that, you can send them to me. I can share them with the people here. They would be really there are certain people that have really interest in that, or information. They need the information on the ideas. They just never thought about it before. If you have some clarity about that, that'd be great if you could share it.
Okay.
Thank you, Maren.
Will you share the name of the school, Maren, in the chat, on the Telegram chat?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Do you know the name of it now?
The school, we are in Montessori school. And in our town in Freiberg, and that's part of a program which makes a woman called Margaret Rasfeld, and she tried to make school difference, school different with the teaching. She talks a lot about going with social competence and working in a different kind of way with the children, really to have the perspective from the children and not from the teacher.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Marvin.
Thank you.
You know, since you guys are the specialists in possibility coaching at this moment, and these guys over here are delivering single coaching sessions, you know, emotional healing processes, and are not really decided what their specialty is. Maybe you could introduce yourselves. Like if you guys over there could explain what was the clue for you that made you realize that actually your specialty is possibility coaching for now. Would you guys tell your stories about when it became clear for you? I mean, who would like to go first?
I go.
Gotcha. Thank you.
I feel so glad to hold space for in one-to-one sessions. For me, this gives the opportunity to really tune in with one person. I realize that my story is that I'm somehow also overwhelmed with more people. So for me, this one-to-one session is a space where it is easy for me to deliver or to let the bright principle flow and to trust in the process.
So when did you decide? When was
it was I don't remember the the exact moment, but when I got the chance to do the possibility coaching training, it was so clear that I will do that.
Thank you. Somebody else?
For me, it was, I saw the EHPs on the channel, YouTube channel, the 100, over 100 EHPs. And I was so touched of this. So I looked one of another, and it was clear I have to learn this. I really want this and this. Yeah, it was really touching for me. And then I decided to go the possibilitator path, and it was clear to go further and to do this coaching, possibility coaching, and to continue what I did before, but in another way, or with these tools, or with this deeper understanding and deeper feeling. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have something similar to Sabina's, as I remember the first time that I saw a YouTube session on the possibility coach session. The sentence, like, what can I do for you? It lands in me. Like, what can I do for you? It's like, I did so much therapy in my life in different ways, and it's so much different, this feel that creates when the person says, what can I do for you? And I'm here, I'm listening to you. And I did also, like, I received, for example, coaching session from Sonia, for example, and there is this sensation of having a space finally, yes. Finally, having a space where I can really move in so many ways, like all my five bodies are moving, not only my intellectual body is moving when I am in a possibility coach session. It's like my five bodies have space to touch new things. And so I didn't see the 100 videos, but I really saw, and I remember that there was a warning at the end of the video, like, you will feel something. And I was like totally inside of the session. I was I was like with the person, with also the coaching. And that's there's something about how much the one person can create this field of transformation from one person. So I sense when I'm holding space for someone, I sense that I'm also holding space for more than one person. Like this is what there's an ecstasy for me from my being. Like, I'm feeling this ecstasy, like there's a space in me. And yes, that's why I'm here. I'm also exploring this ecstasy.
Thank you, Marina.
Exploring
ecstasy, I see. Okay, interesting. Thank you. Somebody else?
I started. I really fell in love with the magic of the healing processes. I think it's the first thing I witnessed from possibility management, or one of them. And it scared the shit out of me. I was with this group of women, and they also easily went into healing processes, and I couldn't. I was just like, okay, please don't, didn't want the space holder to talk to me. But secretly underneath, I really, really wanted them to, so that I could open up and do the same thing that everyone else was doing. And I didn't think I could ever hold space for that. And obviously kept going. And for me, it's the magic. I just love the magic of it, that it goes in totally unknown directions, and who knows, you know, from the beginning is just an empty space, and that it unfolds. So I really, really appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And there's one other thing, which is I really like to see the progress, the progression from step to step. And I have a question how that fits in with possibility coaching now. Yeah.
So what you're witnessing is the manifestation of the matrix being built in a person.
I mean, yeah.
Interacting with the universe differently. They see things differently. They have different options to choose from. They have center grounding bubble. They have more attention, more capacity for choosing consciously. There's all this stuff. So that will happen in every dimension of the path, the possibility management. And so it's, of course, a part of possibility coaching, but it's not yours. You know, it's nice to see it or whatever, but if you're putting little notches in your pistol for everybody who has a miracle, basically you're doing it for you then, which means your ego. You know, you're trying to make miracles happen for your ego. How do you think the universe feels about that? Feels like you're cheating the universe out of miracles. You get it? You're making an enemy out of the universe when you're trying to do miracles for yourself. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, if you're doing it for you, I want to see these steps that somebody's taking. You know, I want to for me, and I did it. You know, I'm the great possibility coach. If you do that, you're screwing yourself out of the connection with the universe. Mm-hmm. What you want to do is be the space through which those forces can do their work in the world, in your spaces, in the spaces that you're holding for your clients. You're just the space. And you get to have the ecstasy, but if you start collecting them, you know, this is a 3% increase from last week. You know, this is not what we're trying to do. That's not it. Doesn't belong in this game world. You see the difference?
Yes.
You're going to measure and take credit for people's steps along the journey. That's not what this is about. So, like, it's more like Marina was saying, is that you get to be this ecstatic space and just keep breathing while the ecstasy is going on. Do your next client. Brush your teeth and floss your teeth and watch one of the movies and go to bed, you know, and then et cetera. But it's not about trying to pull out your file and go, this is your 17th session and you're only at 22%. And oh yeah, you did a jump from 5% up, you know. It's not about that.
Thank you.
Yeah. I wanted to ask these guys if you're doing coaching.
Go ahead. I have something. Okay, Sonny. It's what I experience when I'm holding space in a coaching session. It starts with this point where there's a knot. And
A knot. Yeah.
K-N-O-T.
Yeah.
And to be witness to the person finding your own way inside by inner navigating and go through that. And when that moment comes that they get to the point and the point opens up, this is the value that I receive, is to watch this. There's this unfolding and this release of something else being possible for that person. And she or he is the one that is doing that. They are just discovering the way inside, and then there's boom. And you can see it in their faces, their bodies. And then they go to this next step. And that is transformation and evolution. And yeah, this is my thing.
So are you a possibility coach?
I have many things, and yes, possibility coach is one of them.
Okay. All right. Somebody else?
Yes. What I'm ecstatic about it is when I'm holding a space and it's so nonlinear. It's like a playground to really go nonlinear with impulses. And I remember when I was a teenager, I was like this, what university do you want to do? And I was like, I would do psychologist. And then I didn't get grades to psychologist because universe was like, how can I say, holding space for me. And then I went to tourism and I quit tourism. But the thing about psychology is that I want to be with people. And I know that in the therapy, I would not have that freedom to move and to be with the person in an adventure of these experiments. And I feel so much ecstasy when a person go to an experiment during the week and said, look, I said no to my partner. And it was fantastic. I just didn't have to do dinner anymore. Because she hated to do dinner. And it's this mind-blowing of real, practical, simple transformation. And it's really anchored in reality from one week to another, from the simplicity of saying no can change your life. And this is what turned me on to become a possibility coach. It's this ecstasy.
Thank you. You guys all know each other?
Yes.
Mostly.
Yes.
Good. Wasn't sure.
I don't know the two people on the far ends.
And we're going to have them introduce themselves to you.
Jacqueline
held an amazing space last night of the collaboration, creative collaboration between the masculine and the feminine. She held this space for discussion and research, and it was amazing research happening.
Thank you. And hello, everyone. I'm Jacqueline. I know most of you.
Your full name.
I'm Jacqueline O'Neill. And for the question of am I a possibility coach, I don't know if that's exactly the question.
Do you deliver single coachings or EHPs?
Yes, I've delivered a lot of EHPs.
How many?
Probably 40.
40 EHPs.
Yeah.
Tell them.
Yeah, something like 40 EHPs, I would guess at this point, maybe more. And I really love living it too, I'm sharing my own practice. Like I'm late because I came from a PHP that I just received. So it's really integrating it from both sides and sharing from, not from my own experience as if I know how it goes, but putting myself through the same thing. And and I have done coaching, which is not in the possibility management context. And I have such a deep desire to integrate it, or really just shift in pretty much an only possibility management context with coaching. And I've noticed outside of the context, there's such a, there's so much rhetoric of bad emotions. And I started to bring that context into it. And I said, what you said, fear is your friend. It can be your friend. And people are like, will you be my coach? You know, their mind was blown with just that one sentence. And the coach wanted me to be the coach because they said that one sentence. And I think someone said I need to do an EHP about the fact that I don't believe I'm a possibility coach yet without some credential.
Well, I see five of them over there who would be able to do that process for
you. Great. Thank you. Yes.
Yep.
Thank you.
What I love about possibility coaching is that a session and the situation of a session and me and this other person meeting is that's what is needed. And the other person, it's not so much external what the other person needs, but the resources and the unfoldment or the possibility to unfold the capability of, for example, taking a stand for oneself is already in the person. And it just needs us two to come together and dedicate the space for this purpose. And suddenly such a shift happens. And so what I love about this is that you don't need much. You don't need a boat and a trailer and your certificates and all that. But it's really the commitment of these two people who meet that makes it possible whatever is happening in that space. And this is so nourishing. It's so, just so nourishing as a life experience of this is the way we can live. This is how I can spend time with you and you with me. Either way, we change it, we exchange it. We are both like making these gifts to each other and the world. And so it was like just being a possibility coach is also a healing and transformational path. I think it could be one for anybody or for at least for everybody who wants to offer it as a way to discover that not only the client has already what they need, but also you as a space holder or I as a space holder have what I need. And I'm a complete being. I'm a being that can serve my own purpose. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
For me, possibility coaching fits a little bit together with the feeling practitioner work. And that's one part. And from the really to see what I can do with the what will happen in the EHP then the coaching, the final mark has been really the work with my son who's autistic and really and to see and added to that there comes that is as Marco said this that there's something more could happen. And it's like if a person really opened the doors a little bit for themselves, the door is open, so they go into the world and it changed the world outside also. And it's like the revolution of the roots, grassroots, which will start there. It changed the communication between people. And this is something, it works a little bit different than working in groups. Working in groups is another energy. It's another, if it's like, it would be music, it would be another kind of music and it sounds a little bit different. And that's also pretty and nice. And to make possibility coaching has more. It's like a fine minuet with four or five different instruments.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I am wondering. There has been delivered 3 seasons for possibility coaching training. And I'm wondering why not more people are in the specialty.
I thought by now you guys would have the answer. Do you?
I don't.
Anybody over there?
I didn't get what you said, Clinton.
Well, the question is, why are not more people attracted to or participating in the possibility coaching specialty of the possibilitator training? You know, it's wonderful to be friends. And if that's the main purpose of the team, it will not it's off the mark from what it is originally intended to be, which is to be a kind of magic school. A magic school for learning, to share and learn further and develop and to actually share with the world the treasures and the tools of possibility coaching. I mean, and it's a huge, it's like a Hogwarts for possibility coaching. That's an amazing thing, but it was not being held as, is that, am I telling you new things or I thought you already knew all that?
I wasn't aware that when you say that, it makes totally sense. And I feel sadness, and at the same time also I feel glad, so the space can shift. So I'm very curious what will happen in the future with this space.
I'm holding space for a while for the game world, and for this part of the game world, and we'll keep deepening the sharing, the quality of the sharing, and the tools and the techniques and the empowerment of each other, and build out our circles together and figure out ways to bring possibility management more into the world. Because it's so powerful and it's a miracle. It's a wonder. It's like this really is whatever fabulous juice, whatever it is. And so that's where we are right now. Does that help?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So now there's plenty of space for people to come in if they're interested in being that kind of magician, you know, that kind of magic. One-on-one, holding space, transformation, and healing, or in single coaching sessions, possibility coaching. And it, you know, how to let people know. I mean, basically, we've been keeping it a secret. We've been hiding it from the world because we have not published articles in psychological journals about this kind of coaching. So we haven't joined coaching organizations. You know, and spoken out and said, look, there's this new kind of coaching. We didn't write very many articles or videos to explain stuff. I mean, the 100 videos is certainly a statement. You know, it's really a statement. And how many people know about it yet? Not so many people know about it. So anything that you guys feel like doing to let the message out, to let people know about possibility management, that's fabulous. There's tons of articles that need to be written and researching for different kinds of symptoms and approaches, how to approach different things. I mean, you guys have been your clients have brought you impossible situations. Your clients have mostly all tried therapy and it did not work for them. Is that true? Most of your people have in the traditional coaching and therapy path, and it did not work for them. And so you're dealing with impossible jobs. And it's great to read this book about the White Witch of Tenerife, because Elsa Marika Koster did the same, you know, did that. She's an example for us. You know, and she dealt with the clients that the medical profession failed with. And she just figured out ways to work with them that were completely new and wild. You know, really wild and off the charts, but worked, you know, working. So that's what we're doing also. Yeah.
Will you share your story too, Clinton, about how you became a possibility coach?
Yes. We had started the first expanded box training in 1998 in Germany. And then it was, some people had heard about it. They said, well, we want to do this too. So I said, okay, we'll do another one. Then another, pretty soon more people said, well, we want to do it too. And so we did another one. By the year 2000, I was doing about one a month or one every 2 months, mostly in Germany. And so after people started doing 3, 4, 5 expand the box trainings. And after about 2001, something like that, after the end of the expand the box training, people did not leave. There was about 10, 12, 15 people around. They're looking at me and they said, what's next? And I go, what do you mean what's next? They go, no, what's, there's a lot more that can come through. When's the next thing, the next step, the next level? And so they created labs. They said, we need something. So we came up with a space called labs and we started doing labs. And so we did labs and we, I knew, let's see, every now and then in a lab, I would put up a chair and somebody would sit across from me chair and we would do what some kind of process. And after about three or four labs, where there was in Germany again, I remember it was Sunday afternoon, like, you know, the pretty late Sunday afternoon. And I said, give me a chair. And I put a chair in the middle. And I said, you, come here, sit in the chair. So we did this process, took 10 minutes, something like that, wrapped it up, brought it. Okay, the person went out of the chair and the next person sat in the chair. I go, what? I go, I want to do it too, she said. I go, all right, so we do this process. Well, we did about 20 chair processes in one lab. One, you know, the wrap up of Sunday of the lab was 20 chair processes for me in a row. I was pretty well cooked, like a hot potato. And so I thought, okay, enough of this. You know, that was a wild thing. Well, people came to the next lab and they say, okay, they put the chairs in the middle. Okay, they were. Okay, all right. They said, we want to learn how to do this after a while. They said, we want to learn how to do this. And I said, well, you have to learn how to be centered, grounded, bubble. You have to know how to set context, hold space, and this long list of skills. So by after about your seventh lab, we're going to start to teach you how to do possibility coaching. And then we did that for a couple of years. But then we realized that by the seventh lab, they only had three labs to learn possibility coaching, and it was not enough. And so then we started going, God, but it's insane. These people come to their first labs, we're going to stick them in a chair and have them do a possibility coaching session. And it was like, okay, we're doing this, but get a skilled person, a middle person, and a fresh person, a new person, and do it. So we started doing that. And now what happens is we do an expand the box training. And on day three, we put people in coaching in groups of three, and they do possibility coaching with each other. We do one possibility team and one single coaching session with a coach by groups of three. So it's already in expand the box training. We're teaching people how to do possibility coaching. And so this whole process for me has been mind blowing every step of the way. And it's not my fault. It's you guys. You guys had the intelligence or the preparation to make it possible and the longing to help each other. And then I don't know who it was, Aunt Chloe or somebody started putting these groups together where people could do EHPs online with the EHP support group, whatever it's called.
Cooperative emotional process
group. Collaborative emotional healing group on Telegram. Now people do EHPs before they even did expand a box training. So it's like taking off all by itself. So there's over 500 people in that group around the world now doing EHPs with each other. And building up the skill level to be possibility coaches someone. So it's really for me an amazing victory. And I think we're just beginning to scratch the surface.
Thank you.
Yeah, what I hear here is that we is a magic school. Actually, the purpose of this space is to share even the things that we are bringing in from our session. So the magic that maybe I will create from a nonlinear space, for example. Yeah. So I bring here and I share with you, and then I hear you, and it's an ongoing research, this.
And also you are discovering, all of you are discovering lots of things in your coaching sessions. And all of those things you can bring them together in a newsletter or work docs and nourish your circles and the community. because there are other people doing EHPs and holding space for EHPs that they don't know yet that they are possibility coach. And if you deliver, if you bring this value to the village, you are maybe reaching these people that are on the line and they don't know where to go. And your goal will get to that. And this is how the possibility coaching speciality will unfold and gain more space for people to come into the circle.
I mean, so when not so long ago, a few hours ago, I was working with a woman doing a single coaching session. And she said that, first she said, just okay, I won't mention any names.
I am the woman.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Well, she goes, I go, what can I do for you? She goes, there's this large black demon monster by my right ear, and he's got red eyes, and he's whispering my name, and I can't sleep. I go, ah, okay. So let's talk to him. So she starts talking to this monster thing, and his purpose was to take power away. Is that it? Keep you suppressed.
Yes.
Keep you dominated.
Yes, and to feed.
To feed off of her.
Yeah.
And I go, all right. So this is it's called a contract. This is called a contract with the dark side, and you make an agreement. There was a certain time, and we didn't go through the exact situation, but the agreement was what?
For 1,000 years, he would keep on feeding on me, and he would give me power.
So she had this deal going, and it was coming to the end of the 1,000 years. And that's why it was waking her up in the middle of the night, because he didn't want her to go away when the contract was over. So she went back to the place where she signed the contract, and she brought the contract. And she showed it to this guy. She knocks on the door, and there he is, red eyes, black guy. And he was waiting for her because he already knew the contract was over. And she goes, see this contract? And he goes, yeah. He goes, this contract is over. It's been long enough. She tears it up. She burns it. She walks away. And then I thought the process was over. And she goes, well, actually, in my grounding core, there's this black thing that shows up first. It's kind of just underneath her center there, this black thing. And it won't go away. She tried all these golden pearls and all this stuff. And so we finally tried a few things with the golden pearls. Nothing changed it. So I say, bring it into your hand. So she clicks her clicker, and she brings the black thing into her hand, and she goes, hello, what's your purpose? What was this purpose?
I don't remember.
It was to disempower, it was to control you, something like that. It's completely control your ability to ground with Gaia. And so I'm looking at it, and I'm talking to the thing at the same time, and I said, this thing came from your family. It's part of your family tradition that all the people in your family have one of these black things, and they pass it down to everybody so that you're all the same in your family. You all have the same pain. And if you have the same pain, then you can be a family. And she totally got it. That was it. So she banished it. What did you do? What did you do with it?
It flew off.
Where?
I don't know.
I think into the sun. It went out through the thing, and we threw it into the sun. And it just got burned up. And I said, look, when you talk to your family again, be careful. You know, have an extra layer of your bubble, because they want to make you part of their family, and they'll want to put one of those back on you. You don't have to have that from now on forever. You just live in a different culture from your family, where I don't have one of those black energy sucking demon things on my grounding cord anymore to be a part of this family. So, you know, these are the kinds of this is a huge healing process that you can share with people, you can do for people. It's overtime, ladies and gentlemen. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for being here. Thank you for joining us on this side of the screen and on that side of the screen. We are so glad you guys are doing this.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you for being out there and for sharing this with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. We'll see you later.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, everyone. Bye bye.
Yeah, that's.